Sports Channel presents Chicago White Sox baseball, rich in tradition for over 80 years. From the Sox of the early 1900s to the go-go Sox of the 50s. Don't forget about the team tagged winning ugly to the 1990 team that promises excitement, competitiveness, and youth. Chicago White Sox baseball, take your place in history. From Comiskey Park in Chicago, Illinois, Sports Channel presents Chicago White Sox baseball. This afternoon, the White Sox versus the New York Yankees and the starting pitchers. For the Sox, it'll be the little bulldog, the southpaw Greg Hibbert, and for the pinstripers, the right-hander Andy Hawkins. And hi, everybody, and welcome to Comiskey Park. I'm Ken Harrelson along with Tom Pachurik as the Sox get ready to take on the Yankees in the rubber match of this three-game set as they took it on the chin last night 10-7. But, Tom, also a couple of memorable things happening here today at Comiskey Park. It's the 80th birthday, and it's the last time the New York Yankees will ever play a game in old Comiskey Park.
Isn't that amazing? They've played hundreds of ball games here. Hopefully, they'll go out on a losing note. Now, today's pitcher, Greg Hibbert, has been just outstanding with consistency all year long. But I think a key for Greg is to really establish that breaking ball early in the ball game. He's got the great changeup and the outstanding curveball. But the Yankees are very good against left-handed pitchers.
And his opponent today, Andy Hawkins, he's been struggling. He is 1-4.
Yeah, he really has scuffled as of late. Andy's a good pitcher, though. They signed him as a free agent. New York liked him. He had a pretty good year for him last year, but he really hasn't gotten his act together yet this year.
All right. Hibbert against Hawkins, and Tom will be back with the rest of the starting lineups right after this.
Hi, I'm Paul Reese. Hope you'll join me next time on the bench when my guest will be one of baseball's best relief pitchers, the White Sox, Bobby Figpen. Yeah!
Summer savings advantage of value-packed Plymouth Sundance with $7.50 cash back, or get $1,000 back on sporty Chrysler LeBaron Coupe. Factor to dealer incentives might save you even more. Drive the Chrysler Plymouth Advantage today.
The best is what you get.
Get the best of the 90s at Mancari's Chrysler Plymouth in Oak Lawn.
Sports Channel's coverage of Chicago White Sox baseball is brought to you in part by Budweiser, the king of beers, who reminds you it makes good sense to drink responsibly. Know when to say when. By your Chicagoland and Northwest Indiana Toyota dealers. Toyota, I love what you do for me. By the Illinois State Lottery. Have a ball. Play the lottery. By your Chicagoland and Northwest Indiana Chrysler Plymouth dealers, where the best is what you get. And by Midway Airlines, the airline of choice for the Chicago White Sox.
We're back at Comiskey Park in Chicago. It's a perfect afternoon for baseball. And before we get to the lineups, let's look at our between the lines for this afternoon's ball game. First for the Sox, they got to keep those three top hitters off the base. Kelly, Sachs, and Mattingly, very, very dangerous, the three top hitters in their lineup. So it's very important for Hibbert to keep those guys off the Sachs. Hawkins, I tell you, Andy Hawkins has really scuffled the first three innings of every ball game, so he's got to keep the Sox down early. He's got to get off to a good start this afternoon. And Hibbert, he's got to have that good curveball and changeup working. The Yankees are very tough against left-handed pitchers so far this season. So with that in mind, let's take a look at the lineups for this afternoon's game. First for the Yankees, as given by manager, the Stumper, Stump Merrill, leading off in center field, Roberto Kelly, batting second. Second baseman Steve Sachs. Don Mattingly is back at his familiar third spot playing first base. Cleanup man is the DH, Steve Balboni. Jesse Barfield's in right field hitting fifth. He's followed by the left fielder, Jim Leyritz. Mike Flowers is at third base this afternoon hitting seventh. Bob Guerin catches and hits eighth. And the ninth place hitter, shortstop Alvaro Espinoza. Pitching for the Yankees, right-hander Andy Hawkins. He's been scuffling 1-4 with a 6.49 ERA in 12 starts. And he'll be facing this Chicago White Sox lineup given by manager Jeff Torborg. Leading off in center field, Lance Johnson. Batting second, third baseman Robin Ventura. Yvonne Calderon is the DH this afternoon, hitting third. Cleanup man is left fielder Danny Pasquale. Ron Kittle returns to first base, hitting fifth. He's followed by catcher Ron Karkovic. Scotty Fletcher is the second baseman, hitting seventh. Sammy Sosa in right is the eighth place hitter. And bringing up the rear, El Capitan shortstop Ozzie Guillen. Pitching this afternoon for the Sox, Hawks favorite little bulldog, Greg Hibbert. Hibbert 6-4 with an ERA of 2.59 and 14 starts so far this season. Some more numbers, giving up only 79 hits in 90 and a third innings, 25 walks and 44 strikeouts. And Greg Hibbert in his last start Monday against California, he won that game. Did another outstanding job going 8 1/3 innings, giving up 8 hits, no runs, walking none, and striking out 4. So control is a key factor for Greg Hibbert's success. Career-wise, against the Yankees, he's 1-0 with a 3.72 ERA, and that's over 19 1/3 innings. The weather in Chicago, absolutely perfect for baseball. Clear blue skies, temperature at 66 degrees. Wind out of the north at 16, sunny and pleasant. Wind out of the north could be a good day for the pitchers, that wind blowing straight in from center field. The umpires today, at home plate, Dale Scott. At first base, Vic Voltaggio. Mike Riley, the crew chief, is at second. And at third, Chuck Merriweather. Defensively for the Sox, in the outfield, it's Pasqua, Johnson, and Sosa. Around the horn, Ventura, Guillen, Fletcher, and Kittle. And the battery this afternoon of Greg Hibbert and Ron Karkovic. There's Hibbert. We said early in between the lines, he's got to get good command of that changeup and curveball early in the ball game, because the Yankees are a much stronger team against left-handed pitching. They led the American League last year, 1989, in batting average against lefties. Look at the crowd, sun-drenched out there in center field. Another good crowd on hand. So, Roberto Kelly, ready to start things off. So, here's the Hawkster.
All right, Wimpy, thank you very much. And once again, good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the 80th birthday of Comiskey Park. And the final time that you will ever see that uniform right there at Old Comiskey Park. Sox coming in with a mark of 45-26, one game back of the Oakland A's. The Yankees, 28-44. They are 14 games back in the American League East in last place. But here's Kelly. He's 2-for-7 in the series. Takes it up high. There's a strike, and the count evens at 1. Bunch just a little bit, swung around to the left as it's outside, and the count, 2 balls and a strike. Kelly, 4 homers, 22 RBIs, good speed, and that's off the plate, and the count goes to 3-1. Eighth meeting of the year between these two clubs. Sox hold a 5-2 edge. This is the sixth game played at Comiskey Park. Sox won 4 of the first 5 as you look at the stumper. Got it on the inside corner. So Hibbert comes back, punches out Kelly.
Big strikeout here by Hibbert. Look at it. It's a fastball. Looks like he cut it a bit. You almost call that a slider. Running in and down. A great pitch. It really knocked Roberto Kelly. There you see the last start against the Yankees was May 30th. He won, working 7 1/3 innings, giving up only 4 hits and 2 runs. Walking 2, striking out 3. Good pitch.
Here's the second baseman, Steve Sachs, hitting at 281, a homer, 18 RBIs. He was 2-for-5 yesterday. Takes it off the plate.
You know what made that pitch look so bad to the Yankees is that Hibbert worked him away, and then busted him in on the 3-2 pitch. So he really locked Kelly on that pitch.
Good change. A change from Greg. Now feels straight away and bunch for Sox. Actually, the Sox in a more conventional defense that we have seen against any other club.
against the Yankees.
Yeah. We haven't seen that nickel defense very often.
No. One pitch. There's that change again. Way out.
Great arm speed on that particular pitch.
That's Sachs the thing we talk about, Wimpy, you know, for all the fans sitting at home watching it. You got to watch the motion, the rhythm, and the delivery, and the arm speed on Hibbert's change. And if he's got it, you can sit back and enjoy yourself a good White Sox ball game.
That's very true. You'll get a lot of ground balls to the left side of the infield when he's hot. There's a curveball. Just got a piece of it.
Well, prior to the game, two people that attended this game, and along with two people whose birthday is on July 1st, back in 1910, Emily Joiak, Max Niedorf. That's their birthday. As that's fouled. Also, Gardner Stern and Anamia Bresch. They attended the Comiskey Park inaugural 80 years ago. And boy, they look terrific. Wow. They all threw them. Had the ceremonial first pitch. Looked great. Here's the 1-2 delivery from Hibbert. A pie. Sachs, 30 years old, and as Tom has mentioned many times, he's a gamer. He is a keeper. He plays hard.
Likes hitting off Hibbert, too, as you saw by that last graphic. Good pitch right there. Same changeup. We talk so often at Comiskey Park right here, a bad hitter's background. That green just doesn't go up there high enough out in center field. And if you got a good changeup like Greg Hibbert does, it's really tough to pick up rotation on that particular pitch, so he could be very effective here in the daytime.
That's into right field. Sammy fighting that wind. It was just the reverse of yesterday. It was out of the south, blowing out to right.
A little scary right there. Sammy looks like he may have overrun this a bit. The ball came back just a tad. He's going to be fighting that sun and wind all day long, but that's the guy you want out there if you're the White Sox.
Here's Don Mattingly hitting a .257, 5 homers, 33 RBIs, and he went through the whole month of June without hitting a home run.
Now, that really doesn't surprise me, just watching him swing the bat these 2 days, Chuck. I'm telling you, he doesn't look like he's trying. You hit home runs when you pull the ball.
He's trying. He's just not getting the job done with his strike over.
Well, I think he looks like he's trying to hit the ball the opposite field. You're not going to hit a whole bunch of homers the other way.
No, not Don. You mentioned he's not a slugger.
No, he.
That little comebacker right to Hibbert over the first, and that'll do it. 1-2 grand for the little bulldog, and after a half inning of play, it's the Yankees nothing, and the Sox coming to bat.
Thanks. Okay, you're booked in at 10 o'clock.
No good. I got a 9:30 meeting. Have you seen my appointment book?
It's by the phone.
I can't find it.
It's there. How about Midway?
Midway to the phone?
Midway Airlines. They've got a 7 o'clock, but you're not in their frequent flyer program.
Well, if they got the right schedules, I'll join.
Great. I'll sign you up. Did you find it?
Find what?
Midway Airlines. What flying should be.
Hey, come on. Is this any way to spend the summer? No. Make it a Bud summer with Budweiser, Bud Light, and Bud Dry. Check inside 12 packs and you could win one of 100 Bud Label pools. Look for me, Jeff Altman, where you buy your favorite beer. But we're giving away pools all summer long. It's wet. It's wild. It's Bud summer. Hey, man, you need sunscreen. You're starting to peel. Whew.
Do you need a car? Listen, each year government agencies auction, sell, and liquidate thousands of cars and trucks, and the bidding starts as low as $30. Government vehicles, luxury cars taken from drug dealers, criminals, and thousands more seized, repossessed, sold through bankruptcy proceedings. Now find out how you can grab the car you want at government liquidation and bankruptcy prices. Bid as low as $30 for Porsches, Mercedes, Ferraris, Corvettes, family cars, and trucks. Find out how to get the car you want now. Call 1-900-HOT-AUTO. That's 1-900-468-2886. Just $2 a minute.
The Yankees failed to score in the top half of the first inning, and the Sox will get their first look at Andy Hawkins. But let's first look at the monthly report for the White Sox. 10-6 in April, 18-10 in May, a fine June as well. Overall, 45-26. The home record, 8 over and 11 over on the road. That's really the great stat right there. The road record is terrific. And here's Andy Hawkins, 1-4 with a 6.49 ERA and 12 starts on the season. Giving up a lot of hits, 82 and 68 innings, walking quite a few, more than he has struck out. It's a telltale sign right there. That's why the ERA is up there. And defensively for the Yankees, Leyritz, Kelly, and Barfield, the outfield, Flowers, Espinoza, Saxton, Mattingly around the horn. And the battery today is Andy Hawkins and Bob Guerin. And I did not say that Don Mattingly was not trying. I didn't mean it anyway. Don Mattingly is not trying to hit home runs.
You said it. We've got it on tape. You said it as Lance steps in. Takes the first pitch strike.
I said he's not trying to hit home runs. Don Mattingly may be trying a little bit too hard. He tries as hard as anybody in baseball. So there.
Here's the 0-1 pitch to Lance. Out of play and the count. Quickly two strikes. Lance hitting at 281, no homers, 26 RBIs. He was 1-for-5. He is 1-for-5 in this series thus far. It's in the left field. Jim Leyritz coming on, now fighting that win, and he makes a catch.
Definite win factor today. Oh, that ball came back. My goodness. Leyritz, we saw him play third base in the first two games of this series, and he has to do a number right here. Fine diving catch right there just before it hit the ground. Now the wind is going to play a definite part in the outcome of this game this afternoon. Yesterday was very hot in the Chicago area. Today rather cool, and of course that usually means north winds.
Here's Robin. Robin swinging the bat well. Takes a strike from Hawkins. Robin hitting 313 in his last 112 at-bats. That's fouled out of play, left side over the Sox dugout, and quickly the count 0-2.
Andy Hawkins, from what I've seen of him, Hawk, is a high ball pitcher. He throws a lot of pitches above the belt, actually around the letters, and that is a pitch the White Sox are really going to have to take, especially on a day like today, where it's going to really take a belt to hit it out of the ballpark. So if he pitches upstairs out of the strike zone, they swing at it, chances are they're going to pop it up.
Outside, Bob Guerin trying to frame it in the count, 1-2. Jesse goes back on the track, and he makes a catch. Robin smoked it right to Barfield.
Couple of good plays to start things off for the Yankees defensively. There you see the fastball. Robin gets ahead of the bat on it. Wynn may have brought that one back a little bit. Yesterday would have probably been a homer. Jesse Barfield with a fine play there in right field. He got a good jump on it. That was a tough play because it was hit directly over his head. He had to take that drop step, run to a spot, and then look up and catch it, fighting the sun as well.
Strike on the outside corner.
And that's not Ivan's A swing right there. Hawk Parkins had a lot of trouble in the first three innings. He's got an ERA of 8.39 over the first three innings.
That's in the right field as Jesse moves over, makes a catch, and very quickly, a 1-2-3 inning for Hawkins. And after one, no score.
Got the summertime blues?
Toyota's got the cure for the summertime blues.
Toyota's summer sales event has the summer's biggest savings, like Toyota Camry, with savings up to $700 or more on factory options. Then add in immediate delivery, special financing, and very special summertime factory incentives. Right now, your Toyota dealer has the cure for the summertime blues.
Toyota's got the cure for the summertime blues.
Toyota's summer sales event. Don't miss it.
To cover the news in this town, you gotta have fast feet and a big heart, because this is a gutsy town and nobody.
Stock prices soared Monday to their highest level since last autumn, while analysts predicted the market may find little.
Sports writer, you can't just watch the game. You got to completely absorb it. Every play, every pitch, every strike.
You never know what you'll find on a stage in this town. Chicago's brand of theater is like the city itself. Bold, physical, nervous.
Get it straight from the heart of the city, the Chicago Sun-Times. Chicago's number one selling newspaper.
No score, top of the second inning. And there you see in the American League, Texas at Boston, California at Cleveland, Oakland at Toronto. Tigers take on the Royals in Kansas City, Milwaukee at Seattle, and the Birds against the Twins in Minnesota. National League, Atlanta at Montreal, Houston, Philadelphia, Cincinnati at New York. Pittsburgh at San Francisco, Cubs at San Diego, and St. Louis at Los Angeles as Balboni takes a strike from the left-hander Greg Hibbert. Bye-bye hitting at 306, eight, check that, 217, seven homers, and 18 RBIs. Two balls and a strike. Left side, Ventura. Jesse Barfield, hitting at 257. He's 3-for-8 in the series with a couple of ribbies.
You missed it, Hawk, and our monitor back there. Kevin Seitzer just got nailed right on the KC of his helmet by Jack Morris. Hopefully he's all right.
Barfield takes a strike. The slider, Ozzie way back, long peg, yes.
Perfecto right there by Ozzie. Got jammed severely right here. And here's Ozzie making the backhand play. And you can see his right foot sliding because the grass is still a little bit wet after the ground crew waters the field. Just prior to the ball game, you see Jesse try to get that left arm through. Doesn't quite do it. And Ozzie sets, throws. Actually, it may have helped him because he didn't even step with his left foot. His right leg just slid back. That may be a new way of, innovative way of throwing the ball now.
Wrong.
You're right. That is wrong.
As Laritz steps in, Jimmy hit his first major league home run yesterday. That was in the third inning. And then in the ninth inning, came right back with his second major league home run.
And they were big league homers, too. He got every inch of those. Ooh, good curveball.
Well, I was talking with Stump Merrill after the ball game. Laritz, catcher. He said, He will go at times behind the plate when he is as good defensively behind the plate as anybody. And that, of course, stump has been around a long time, and that ball's hit hard. Ozzy will continue that later. 1-2-3 for Hibbert. Nothing across, and after an inning and a half, no score.
Time now to look back at a glorious memory from Comiskey Park's historic past.
For 10 glorious years, the Sox jersey displaying number 3 was worn by White Sox great Harold Baines. The left-handed Sox slugger from Maryland was noticed as a youth by former White Sox owner Bill Veeck. Harold Baines proved to be one of the finest players ever to play for the White Sox. Harold is the all-time home run leader with 186.
Well, there it goes, deep center field.
He is second in runs batted in with 819, third in doubles, and sixth in hits. As the Sox fans chanted Harold, Harold from the stands, Harold Baines delivered. He blasted 20 or more home runs, a club record, during six consecutive White Sox seasons. Harold represented the White Sox four times as an American League All-Star, and twice was named the Outstanding American League Designated Hitter, 1987 and 1988. Harold Baines, a Comiskey Park legend.
Danny hitting at 306, 8 homers, 25 ribbies. He had one of the longer singles we have seen this year yesterday, and he hit a rocket off the top of the wall in right field. Caromed right back to Jesse, and he held him to a single. Oakland at Toronto, tied at one. That's in the top of the third inning. California at Cleveland, tied at two. Bottom of the second. Technically, bottom of the fifth. Off-speed pitch, Pascoe way out in front. And it's 1-2. What Danny's done against his former mates. Two strikes. Well, congratulations to that gentleman right there on such a terrific season. Bill Jackson, coach of the Bulls. Wow, what a great year. A lot of thrills they gave all of us here in Chicago. We'll get them next year. Hey, they had a pretty good draft, weren't
yeah.
they?
Yeah.
Ooh. Oh, that's a good change. Right
there is a good changeup by Andy Hawkins. He didn't have that the first time around. First time he pitched against the Sox, and this is an outstanding changeup. Good arm action right here. You see him just turning it over slightly, and the ball actually goes straight down.
That's a different looking Hawkins than we saw the first time.
Yes. Whoa, he was basically a fastball slider pitcher with not overpowering stuff with either one of those pitches, and they both look the same speed.
Here's Kitty. First Kitty's homer one in the opener, 1-0. That pitch up high. Talking with Steve Shanewald, marketing director of the Bulls, yesterday, and Stevie was saying that foreign player, what's his name? They drafted.
Yeah.
Kulik there.
Kulik.
Kulik. 6'10 shooting guard.
Great.
That's awesome.
They can't get him up for this year, though, can they?
No. But the thing is, you know, when you and I were coming up, if you were 6'10, you couldn't even hardly walk in a straight line.
That's true.
These guys today are just, it's not so much that they're getting bigger, it's just the bigger guys are getting more agile and better.
Sure.
Wow.
That hurt. Got him on the left forearm here. he puts that right arm hand behind him to protect it. But, ooh, the left hand. Yeah, right there, right in that elbow where that bicep comes in, yellow. Forearm, that area. Ooh.
So the count, 2 balls, 2 strikes to the big man from Gary. Just watching the signs of Guerin right here. Indeed, Hawkins threw a lot of breaking pitches in the first outing against the Sox. And Guerin's been putting the slider down in the curveball, and Hawkins been shaking him off. He wants to throw the fastball. So that's an indication that he has confidence in it and he feels good.
Yeah, he looks like he's got a little bit more zip on it. Now upstairs, you really can't chase it. As we said earlier, he's a high ball pitcher. He gets a lot of outs that way. Like it's, well, that's fastball away, doesn't it?
Yeah, he gave him the change, and Hawkins just looked at him as he strikes him out on the fastball. That's one reason I really enjoy watching the signs of the catcher, you know, early in the ball game, especially because of the fact you can get an indication when he's putting down numbers. You can get an indication of how the pitcher feels. If in fact he's shaking, if the guy's putting down fastballs, he's going to the breaking ball. It tells you he didn't have a whole bunch of confidence in his fastball, and vice versa.
Sure.
Here's Carrick hitting a 278, 3 homers, 7 RBIs. Now here's a breaking ball. Carrick goes through the heater and the count 1-1.
Fastball.
Threaded the needle.
Carco's been playing great in his last three starts, hit 417. That's 5 for 12. 2 home runs in that time. Look out. Whoa. Guerin thinks the ball hit his bat. Dale Scott says no. Look at this.
Right there as Alvaro Espinoza fighting the sun makes the catch, and that'll retire the side. So both pitchers have retired the side in order in the first two innings, and after two, no score.
Good times roll with the clean, fresh taste of Bud Light. It won't fill you up, never let you down.
I say I'm lucky. I know I'm lucky. This is my lucky day.
Here at Sports Channel would like to welcome our affiliate Jones Intercable and their subscribers in Lake Zurich, Illinois. Lake Zurich, yes. Here's Mike Blowers, the third baseman. It'll be Blowers, Guerin, and Espinoza as Greg Hibbard has retired the first 6 Yankees in order. You see the numbers on Michael. One of the Yankee rookies. They have 4 on this ball club, and as you mentioned yesterday, that's the first time I ever can recall 4 rookies on a Yankee ball club.
Yeah, more often than not, you'd have 1 at the max. They don't like to go with the youth. They like that experience over there in New York, but it really hadn't paid off for them recently. So now the youth movement.
There's some funny things that have happened in baseball in the past couple of seasons. And when I say that, unusual things. We saw a club assembled this year with the highest payroll in baseball. There are a lot of people were picking to win the American League West. The Kansas City Royals, with a $23 million payroll. And last year we saw a Baltimore Orioles team relatively lower down in the pay scale carry their season down to the last 2 days of the year before Toronto beat them out. And this year we're seeing the 1990 Chicago White Sox with the youngest team in the major leagues, and they are battling it out for first place against the high-priced Oakland A's. So some unusual things happening. That's Ozzie, two-hopper.
Very unusual. You got to mention the word hungry. Who's hungriest for that title?
Well, you know, when you're talking about the Sox being a low-priced ball club as far as salaries go, it just goes to show that there are some good decisions being made at management level. And all of a sudden you can have, because if from a business standpoint, that's the optimal.
Sure.
The optimum would be what? To have the lowest paid club with the best record in baseball. Now that is the optimal. And the Sox, 2 days ago, had that.
Yeah, that's amazing. Oh, both? Lowest pay plus?
And the best record.
Of course, the better you get and the more games you win in future years, that just turns around. This guy's got to start making a little bit more money.
Oh, yeah. Oh, sure. No, you can't have that year in and year out.
That's right. You will never have that 2 years in a row.
Never.
No.
2-0 the count to Guerin.
Well, I've said about Kansas City from the get-go, if George Brett did not have a good year, a great year, typically George Brett in his prime, Kansas City wouldn't be a factor. There's Larry Himes, Dr. Frankenstein. He created this monster over here.
That's outside in the count 3-0. Never upset with himself.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I picked Kansas City to win the West. I thought with that pitching staff that they had assembled over there, it could equal the one in Oakland. As you look at Jeff Torborg, what a job he and his staff have done this year. I'll tell you, they have been consistent. They have been consistent. The manager and the coaches, the players come to the park every day. They know what their role is. They know what they're going to do. And that's, boy, that's the best thing you can give a ball player. Fastball strike.
Well, the one thing that I've noticed about Jeff and the coaching staff that I absolutely love is when a player messes up, they get to him immediately. As soon as that half inning is over with, they tell him what they did wrong and tell him, hey, don't do it again. There's strike two. And it really works. I've seen managers never just let the whole thing blow over, even with the veteran team, and never even point it out. Never even point it out the next day, and that doesn't work.
A lot of those managers that you've seen do that are scared.
Yeah.
Of the players.
And that's just, during the course of the season, they will continue to make that same mistake. White Sox players don't make the same mistake, very often, twice.
Except on the base pen.
Well.
They are a running bunch of Jessies once they get on first base.
Uh-huh. Got to get the lasso out to stop them, but it's worked.
Broken bat, Ventura. To go.
That's a nice. Well, Greg Hibbert. Tell you how effective he has been so far, retiring the first eight. He has one strikeout, one flyout. 7 ground balls. And 6 of them have been to the left side of the infield. So when you see that, you know that Greg Hibbert's having a good day because they're trying to pull that off-speed pitch.
Plus the fact that he was 3-0 on Guerin. I like it. He came back. He was 3-1 on Kelly. He came back and struck him out. Left side.
Thank you.
Ventura. That's 9 in a row for Hibbert. Nothing across, and after 2.5, no score.
because Schaumburg Toyota, the Midwest's largest volume Toyota dealer, has exceeded every Toyota quota with three times the volume and three times the inventory, Schaumburg Toyota can now offer you maximum incentive savings on Toyota's three bestsellers with up to $1,200 in factory incentives on new Toyota Camrys, factory incentives of up to $1,200 on Toyota Tercels, and up to $1,200 in factory incentives on Toyota Corollas at Schaumburg Toyota, Toyota's factory incentive headquarters, 875 West Gulf Road. Hurry, sale ends August 2nd.
Stay tuned for more hot summertime fun in August on Sports Channel. The last season ever at Comiskey Park is winding down, and the White Sox are gearing up for the pennant race against the likes of Milwaukee, Kansas City, Texas, Toronto, Oakland, California, and Minnesota. Follow today's hottest tennis players at the oldest professional tennis tournament in the country. It's the U.S. Pro Tennis Championships, and you won't miss a single serve, volley, or forehand as the top players compete in this prestigious event. Football fans won't miss a beat with Sports Channel's exclusive coverage of the Canadian Football League. It's a unique brand of football with a longer field and less downs, sure to keep the game moving. Plus, don't miss the 1990 Chicago Baseball Cancer Charities Golf Special, an encore presentation of the Chicago Bulls 3-on-3 Shoot the Bull Special, Intercollegiate Rowing Championships, NASCAR Racing, and much, much more on Sports Channel in August.
Who'd have thunk it? Yes.
They spelled it right, too. It's great, isn't it?
No score, bottom of the third. On the 80th birthday of Comiskey Park, it'll be Fletcher, Sosa, and Ozzie to face the right-hander, Andy Hawkins. Nary side has had nary hit, or nary base runner. That's in the right field.
It's an interesting... Oh, you got something to say there, Hawk? Go ahead.
Yeah, about you, as a matter of fact. You get the inside scoop on Chicago's Boys of Summer tomorrow at 6:30 on White Sox Weekly with my partner, Whippy. You'll see highlights from the Sox sweep over the Angels in Anaheim to put them on the top of the AL West. Also, Sox skipper Jeff Torborg begins a series of proper catching techniques. And don't miss White Sox Weekly for this and more tomorrow at 6:30 on Sports Channel. And also, Jeff will be modeling the new Sox uniforms for 1991. And it's White Sox Weekly, tomorrow, 6:30, with Tom Petrick, Jeff Torborg, right here on Sports Channel. Sammy takes the breaking ball strike.
A little slurve there. I haven't seen the new uniforms, have you?
No, I heard they're gorgeous.
No. They'll be nice. Make sure your first look tomorrow night.
Last ball on its way. Got it on the fist of Sammy. And quickly, the count 0-2.
What I started to say earlier, though, Hawk, is an interesting comparison between the two pitchers. Greg Hibbert, obviously a low-ball pitcher, has been getting nothing but ground ball outs. He has the one strikeout, one flyout by Steve Sachs. Last seven guys have been retired on ground balls to the left side of the infield. And, on the other hand, Andy Hawkins, get to that in a second, there's a fastball up and away. He has two strikeouts, and everybody else has been retired in the air by fly balls. Nothing hit really hard except for Ventura, so he's a high ball pitcher.
That fastball foul back. Count remains 1-2.
Fly ball pitcher against a ground ball pitcher. The ground ball pitcher right here, Hibbert, is doing much better. ERA, he's pitching a lot more innings, giving up less hits, and look at so many more innings pitched. Leads and walks. Neither one of them is a strikeout pitcher. Look at the opponent's batting average. 300 against Hawkins, only 231 against Greg.
Breaking ball looped out in the short right field. Here comes Jesse.
Ooh, I thought it was going to flip in there. Another fly ball out for Hawkins. He is a fly ball pitcher.
Toronto has just taken a 2-1 lead over Oakland in the bottom of the fifth inning. A triple by Manny Lee. Scored Pat Border. Situation one in, man on third, and nobody out. Yes.
Come on, you Bluebirds.
Here's Ozzie. Ozzie 0 for 7 in the first two games. Yeah, we're definitely seeing a different Andy Hawkins. He has a lot of confidence in that number one. And what they'll tell you is besides velocity, he has a lot of confidence on his location.
Yeah, by far the best stuff that I've seen him have since he's been in the American League. We're only in the third inning, but you can see a remarkable difference. Last three starts, he's been tough. 2.75 ERA, but no decisions. He had no decisions in the month of June.
Here's a 1-1 fastball. Took just a little something off that one, missed outside.
Yeah. Ball tailed away, went down a bit.
Turned it over on him.
Mm-hmm. He's got a few more pitches, looks like, to work with. Last time we saw him, he threw a cut fastball and a slider. That was it.
That's hard hit, a right two. Alvaro Espinoza. And that'll do it for the Sox. Another 1-2-3 inning. That's three in a row for Hawkins. And after three, no score.
Summer savings advantage of value-packed Plymouth Sundance with $7.50 cash back, or get $1,000 back on sporty Chrysler LeBaron Coupe. Factory to dealer incentives might save you even more. Drive the Chrysler Plymouth Advantage today.
Get the best of the 90s at Aero Chrysler Plymouth in Midlothian.
How do you get real premium beer taste in a non-alcoholic brew? You start with a real premium beer. That's how Anheuser-Busch makes O'Doul's. O'Doul's is carefully brewed, fully fermented, and cold-aged. Then the alcohol is naturally removed, retaining all the great taste. So how do you get real premium beer taste in a non-alcoholic brew? Ask for an ice-cold O'Doul's. O'Doul's, the taste will win you over.
Bulls fans, we don't sit on our hands. We make the loudest noise in Chicago town. We raise the roof right up, and the sound comes down. We are the six man.
Coming this summer, Budweiser presents...
We are the Bulls fans!
The Shoot the Bull 3-on-3 Classic. There are divisions for all ages and levels of ability. Call 943-5800 for details, or...
We are the six man!
Check the Chicago Tribune.
We are the Bulls fans!
Here's a reminder that White Sox games are always more enjoyable with a group of friends or colleagues. For more information on single-game sky suites, special group rates on picnic and patio parties, call the White Sox group sales office at 312-924-1000. And there are suites still available for this homestand against Detroit and Baltimore. So come out and see the Sox and enjoy it from one of those great sky suites.
Roberto Kelly hits the first pitch to Ozzy.
Yeah. Ozzy has been a busy camper out there. That's 1, 2, 3 ground ball out swung. Pretty routine for the Ozaru. Tell you what, Greg Hibbert's really got an advantage, don't you think, Hawk, having those two guys on the left side of the infield when you know he's going to face a lot of right-handed hitters and they're going to inadvertently try and pull them. They won't be effective doing it, but Ozzy and Robin Ventura on that left side of the infield have just been terrific.
I think it's the toughest side, left side of the infield in the American League. Don't know about the National League, but in the American League, in my opinion, that's the toughest side to get a ball through. Right here, Ventura and Ozzy.
Mm-hmm. And with Greg Hibbert, of course, taking advantage of that being a low ball pitcher. He appreciates it as much as anyone.
I would say the next toughest would be Fernandez and Gruber.
Yeah.
I don't think Kelly has as much range at third as Robin, and for that reason, that's the reason I think that ours is a little stronger, mm-hmm. A little tougher to get it through.
Sure.
Two balls, no strikes to Sachs. Fly to right.
Can't think of anybody else.
No, there's not.
In that league.
Not in this league. That's broken bat right side.
That's good. Let me finish that statement. Good pitching. Steve Sachs trying to go the other way, but it's nubs it off the end of the bat. So he's 0-2.
Well, our boy Junior Felix came through with a single to score Manny Lee. So the Blue Jays, two runs in, man on first, one out, as they lead the A's 3-1, bottom of the fifth.
All right.
Dinney on a little half swing hit a comebacker to Hibbert his first trip. Curveball off the end of the bat, right side. Yes. 12 in a row. Retired by Hibbert, and after three and a half, no score.
I've always loved watching baseball. Nothing beats an ice-cold Coke at Comiskey Park. But being from a family of centers, I was never too good at playing baseball.
You could get hurt trying to catch a curve this way.
Kids, get White Sox baseball cards at the July 29th Sox Brewers game and hear the Sox on all-new 67.
The last season in historic Comiskey Park. Years from now, you'll say you were there.
There's one of the original Crimson Fannies right there.
Yep. You never did that, did you?
Never. Here's Lance. He popped up to left field.
That would ruin all the wonderful things I think about you.
Outfield, short, swung around to the left. Takes it up high. Here we are in the bottom of the fourth inning. And nobody has reached base yet. Mercy.
Pretty unusual. Both pitchers are in a pretty good groove, though. No doubt about it.
They're both working very quickly. They're getting it and throwing it. They both have a good routine.
Yes, very much so. They're not thinking a whole lot. Don't give the hitters a whole lot of time either. And plus, their defense has been very good, too. They're on their toes.
Sacks. You'll see some sparkling defensive plays from that guy out there on the mound. He is working quickly as you look at Melito's brother.
That's him. I'll tell you what, he was throwing a daylight out of the ball. Reports on him, first few times that he pitched for the Yankees this year, he was outstanding. Unfortunately for him and the Yanks, injured his arm, and they don't know when he's coming back.
Here's Robin. Takes a fastball strike. Robin hit a rocket out to right field at Barfield. Made a nice play going away from home plate on. There's another hard hit. Right to Sacks. Quickly two out. Sheesh. All right, Yvonne's going to break it up right here.
Good call. Good call. Good call.
Now, the last time he came up, Hawkins showing a lot of confidence in that fastball, throwing three straight fastballs.
Three fastballs away, too.
Yeah, let's see how they can try to work in here.
Change some sort of breaking ball.
Up the middle, Espinoza. One, two, three inning for Hawkins. Half to four, no score.
Is an art. I've done it for years. I love working with nature's own ingredients. I love carrying on a skill that's been passed down for generations. And I love reaching that moment when a good beer becomes a great one. We brew our beer with great care. It just isn't right to abuse it.
A reminder from Budweiser.
Got the summertime blues?
Toyota's got the cure for the summertime blues.
Toyota's summer sales event has the summer's biggest savings, like Toyota trucks, with savings up to $700 or more on factory options. Then add in immediate delivery, special financing, and very special summertime factory incentives. Right now, your Toyota dealer has the cure for the summertime blues.
Toyota's got the cure for the summertime blues.
Toyota's summer sales event. Don't miss it.
That's the story. Top of the fifth inning. And a reminder, Milk Duds and Jolly Rancher Candies offer kids a chance to become a celebrity bat boy or girl. Winners receive great prizes and the chance to go down on the field here at Comiskey Park to meet Sox players. And today's winners are Jaime Baum and Lucas Niekamp. Here's Bye-Bye. Bounced out to Ventura's first trip. Takes a fastball off the plate.
Who are those guys again?
Balboni. It's high in the count, 2-0.
Yep, you're right.
Thank you. There's the strike. And the count, 2-1. Beauty. Give him the good arm action. He did. Pops him up. Ventura on a good change from Hibbert.
Fooling those Yankee hitters with that outstanding arm action on the changeup. Sometimes it's not in the greatest of location, but the arm speed is so good and the change of speeds just excellent.
Boy, that's a good call right there, Wimp, because even if you do, as you mentioned, make a mistake in location, if you've got that good arm action like Hibbert has had thus far, you can get by with some mistakes.
Sure. And that changeup makes that fastball look a little bit quicker, too.
About a foot and a half.
Oh, yeah.
Here that comes. Give him a good arm action. Did he? That's it.
Get foul.
Going foul.
Great play. My goodness. Bare hand.
Our fans just shine. They are outstanding.
This guy will not be denied. Get some high fives. You deserve them, buddy.
I don't like that hat he's wearing, though.
No, but look at these hands. Piece of cake.
Swirling around home plate. Gotta hit a good spot right here. Just misses the outside corner and a count 2-1. Shirt out there behind the background. Barfield's had a couple of instances in this series thus far where he has had a problem with somebody moving around back there. Watch out. That fastball completely fooled him. Jesse was sitting on that local right there and got the express.
Yeah, he did. He was way late.
You can heat him up right here. You got two options the way Hibbert's been throwing. Heat him up and inside a little bit, or give him that real good motion with the change. There are two options right here. This is what Cart wants to go with.
Well, he got him out inside last time with a hard slider in on the hands. He broke his bat.
I don't know. That's the whole thing. Here
that
comes
was like change.
Change,
yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
There's that good change.
As we keep pointing out, it wasn't in a good location. The pitch was up and away. But he had Jesse completely fooled by the arm action. The speed of the pitch is of maximum importance right here, especially when you set him up with the fastball in the previous pitches. Actually, he missed that pitch with the end of his bat. Had he made contact, it would have been a number off the end.
To Ozzie his first trip. A only just 26 years old. We were talking about him earlier. That Stump Merrill says that he's just not durable behind the plate. But when he is back there, that he's as good as anybody. Said if he plays 3 or 4 or 5 days in a row, he has a tendency to get hurt. And again, it's just an illustration and a compliment to a guy like Carlton Fisk, who has played all these years. Is that hit in the left field? That's playable. Pascal. That is 15 in a row retired by Hibbert. They will go to the bottom of the fifth inning. Scoreless.
Do you need a car? Listen, each year government agencies auction, sell, and liquidate thousands of cars and trucks, and the bidding starts as low as $30. Government vehicles, luxury cars taken from drug dealers, criminals, and thousands more seized, repossessed, sold through bankruptcy proceedings. Now find out how you can grab the car you want at government liquidation and bankruptcy prices. Bid as low as $30 for Porsches, Mercedes, Ferraris, Corvettes, family cars and trucks. Find out how to get the car you want now. Call 1-900-HOT-AUTO. That's 1-900-468-2886. Just $2 a minute.
Get the summer savings advantage of value-packed Plymouth Sundance with $750 cash back, or get $1,000 back on sporty Chrysler LeBaron Coupe. Factory to dealer incentives might save you even more. Drive the Chrysler Plymouth Advantage today.
The best is what you get.
Get the best of the 90s at Larry Roche's Elmhurst Chrysler Plymouth in Elmhurst.
I've always loved watching baseball. Nothing beats an ice-cold Coke at Comiskey Park. But being from a family of centers, I was never too good at playing baseball.
You could get hurt trying to catch a curve this way.
Kids, get White Sox baseball cards at the July 29th Sox-Brewers game. And hear the Sox on all-new 67.
The last season in historic Comiskey Park. Years from now, you'll say you were there.
This copyright program is presented by the Authority of Major League Baseball and the Chicago White Sox. It is intended solely for the private, non-commercial use of our audience. Any publication, reproduction, retransmission, or other use of the pictures, descriptions, and accounts of this game without the express written permission of Major League Baseball, the Chicago White Sox, and Sports Channel Chicago is strictly prohibited. You know what I mean?
It's the bottom of the fifth inning. Pasqua, Kittle, and Carcavice. And how long has it been? A little trivia question for you. How long has it been since you've seen a game halfway finished and nary a base runner?
Never. I don't think I have.
I'll tell you, there has yet to be a base runner in this ball game. Both pitchers, Hibbert and Hawkins, have been perfect. Greg threw five, and here, and Hawkins threw four. I don't ever recall. Play four and a half innings and not a base runner?
I've seen some great pitchers' duels over the years, but my goodness, I don't ever remember nobody ever getting on base.
Well, I mean, it's very, very possible it could have happened.
Oh,
you
sure.
Know, but I don't recall it. See, Hawkins wants that. He wants to throw that fastball.
Inside, too.
Jammed it. Flowers will not be able to get there.
Well, Hawkins being a high ball pitcher is a better matchup against the White Sox, because you have to say that the Sox are a low ball hitting team.
Blown away hitting team.
Yep.
Is that unbelievable?
Yeah.
That's unbelievable. You got a major league team that's a good low and away hitting team. Where the power is.
Staying inside here. Nope.
To throw that fastball again. Guerin trying to get him to throw the change. And there's the high heat, as Tom talked about.
He's got much more velocity than this afternoon than he did at Yankee Stadium when we first saw him pitch. There it is, up and away. Danny Pascal wants that pitch down a bit.
Jammed him again.
That's a jammage right there. He didn't even hit it high enough for the catcher to get over there and catch it.
Guerin didn't pick it up real quick. He thought the ball was out of play and then tried it. But you're right. He still couldn't have made the catch.
Well, he's living inside on Pascua.
Well, you can see it coming as far as Hawkins, you know, as we mentioned back in the second inning. Wimpy, it's when Guerin was putting down the three and the two and the change, and he wanted that number one. Boy, that'll tell you a lot about a guy, how he feels that day.
He obviously believes in that fastball this afternoon, no doubt about it.
Well, Mark Connors is the bullpen coach over here, and I think one of the more astute pitching minds in the American League. And that's popped up, left side. Jimmy Lafritz fighting that wind. Makes the catch. And, of course, Mark Connors, Billy Connors is a pitching coach, but I'm sure they confer. Mark Connors is a great believer in the fastball. And you show me a guy who's really a great believer in the fastball. It's like Gabby Hartnett. I was fortunate enough to be on a team that he was a coach on when I was a rookie in Kansas City as Kitty steps in. He says, in his opinion, Gabby's opinion, the secret to being a good catcher was taking a guy's second best pitch and making it an out pitch. If you could take his second best pitch and make it an out pitch, then you're doing your job as a catcher. Now, what he's saying by that is you're taking a guy's best pitch because it's hard to get by on one, and you're giving him two alternatives. There's a breaking ball, one of the few he's thrown, and the count 1-1.
Well, another thing that he has changing speeds a lot better. He was pretty much one speed. He's throwing hard fastball, hard slide, and they really weren't that hard. Now he's got throwing somewhat of a slurve and a changeup this afternoon.
Jammed him with an inside fastball. Blowers.
Coming back.
Yep. Well, from a hitting standpoint, maybe this game is going a little too quick.
Yeah, it is.
You know, from a hitting standpoint, if I were playing in a game like this, I'd just take all the time when I went up to the plate. I'd try to get Hawkins out of that rhythm and that routine he's in.
Yeah, he's in that quick rhythm. He's getting the ball and he's throwing it, much like Greg Hibbert. They're both working very quickly, and their defensive team obviously very sharp also, but they haven't had to make any great plays yet.
Got that fastball by him.
Aside from the play that actually Barfield made on Ventura, how many balls have been hit hard in this game? That was probably it.
Ventura's hit too hard. One he scalded, the other was hit semi-hard. Barfield hit the ball fairly hard. First time up in the hole. Ooh. A breaking ball. Like it was a strike. Clark will take it. And the count 2-1. Sales guy said, okay, I blew it, let's go.
Guerin's telling him all about it, too.
Yeah, right. Payback.
Whoa. My goodness.
There's more gas.
Look at Guerin's setting up. I mean, he's setting up in the left-handed batter's box, and the umpire's staying right there. See, Dale Scott, when Guerin moves way out, when he wants that pitch way outside, he's staying right where he is, so he's pretty much blocked out of the outside corner.
We're seeing a nice thing here as far as the art of pitching and catching. We're seeing two batteries that are really in sync together. They're working as a tandem. That's inside. Ball four. That's the first base runner of the ball game with two out here in the bottom of the fifth inning.
And the Yankees don't like it. That was a fastball. It really came riding in on Karkovice. Let's take a look at it. That ball's running inside, in and off the plate. You're saying if you were umpiring, you'd call that a strike?
I'd have rung him up.
Yeah, well, I mean, you can't give him a couple inches on the inside, give him 3 inches inside after giving him 3 inches on the outside. Well, how big is that plate now?
They've got something good going out there today. I'd have rung him up. Here's Fletcher.
You and Ed Runge.
That ball gets away from Guerin. Here goes Clark. Look at the effort by Bob Guerin. Mercy, what a good effort. I imagine it'll be a pass ball. What an effort he gave.
Yep. look at this pitch. It's a fastball. He just misses it. Just misses it. And Karkovice, take your hat off to Karko, too. He got a good jump and made it to second base. There are some guys in this league that would have not budged off of first.
Not our guys.
No. No, not this team. No, they would probably tried for third on that. Some of them.
Come on, Scotty, pick him.
Ooh,
up.
Good swing.
One and one to count. Broken bat single, Scotty. Come on, Scooter.
You can do it.
That's what players say to themselves on the bench in a situation like this. Oh, look one over a second, Scooter.
Oh, there's that inside fastball.
Two and one to count.
Scotty's hitting .476. He's 10 for 21 against the Yankees this season with a homer and four RBIs.
He's 7 for his last 16. Three hits yesterday. Coming alive. Three and one.
And Sammy on deck. Okay. Hitters count. There's the stumperoo.
For the first time this afternoon.
And good job by Scotty Fletcher. He's sitting on fastball, and he didn't swing at the breaking ball. Didn't get himself out. So runners at first and second. Out for Sammy.
Sammy 8 for his last 23.
Key for Sammy's to lay off that high fastball with Hawkins. He's had his biggest problems with that pitch. The fastball up and away. Make it come down, you hit it up the middle and get that base hit.
Second, Fletcher at first. Lays off the high gas, and the count evens at one. When the day comes that that young man right there, 21-year-old Sammy Sosa, his time is foul so often, learns how to lay off the high fastball up out of the strike zone, you're going to see one heck of an offensive player. Two and one.
All right. He's got to come down to you sooner or later, Sammy. be ready to pull that trigger. Hawkins knows he wants to pitch Sammy upstairs.
For the Sox, nothing across, no hits, no errors, couple of men left, and after five, no score. Mercy.
I take care of my body, play a lot of sports, play to win. I go to Sport Mart. They got the best at the best prices.
For the way you play.
The everyday Sport Mart price is guaranteed the lowest in town. I get the difference in cash. It's the ESP guarantee.
For the way you play.
Save on men's over-the-calf cotton tube socks from Ridgeview. All white or assorted stripes. Six-pair value pack, just $9.96 at Sport Mart.
Sport Mart, all the way you play.
There's something new coming to you from Budweiser. Something completely new. It's completely different and completely refreshing. Introducing Bud Dry. It's cold filtered for smooth draft taste and dry brewed for no aftertaste. So if you're looking for smooth draft taste and no aftertaste, try Bud Dry.
No score, top of the sixth. Here's a reminder, the White Sox are offering fans a unique opportunity to go back in time and experience a game at Comiskey Park in 1917. Breyer's Ice Cream's Turn Back the Clock Day will take place Wednesday, July 17th, when the Sox take on the Brewers at 1:35. White Sox will wear 1917 replica uniforms. General admission seats will be 50 cents, and all other tickets half price. You can't beat that deal. Call Ticketmaster at 312-559-1212. Look at Hibbert, 59 pitches, 37 strikes.
Left side Ventura. Here's a catch of Bob Guerin. He also bounced out to Ventura. Then four ground balls to Robin. Four to Ozzie. Two balls hit out of the infield. Good change. Excellent. Slider. Ooh, he didn't get in quite deep enough. That was danger zone right there. And the count 0-2.
That's a hanger. Jeff Torborg happy to see that ball hit straight back. So it's two strikes.
So was Hibbert.
Yeah. Tell you what, you can get away with a lot of hanging pitches today. That ball, Sammy Sosa, that's an upper tank shot yesterday.
Ventura backs up. That's a tough play for Robin. It's going to be a base hit for Bob Guerin. It's a play certainly Robin could have made, but it would have been a very difficult play.
Made a tough one right here. Watch the topspin. It's an 0-2 curveball. Pretty good. I'll tell you what, the ball went down. He probably could have wasted it a little bit better. And that boy, that ball had some bodacious topspin. Look at it, just kind of eats Robin up right there. The only way he'd had a chance at that one, if he'd have been able to charge it just a bit, get it on the short hop, get that in-between hop, those are tough. Those are the ones that eat you up.
I don't think, that was an either-or situation. I don't think, in this particular scenario, that's a base hit. Something wrong with Bob Guerin down there. I don't know. I think I might, Robin, as I said, it would have been a tough play for him to make. No I think I ought to give him an arrow.
I agree.
Of course, the way things go today, you know, there was a... Did you see the error on the replay that Cal Ripken Jr. made?
No.
Did they recall? It was an error. It was an error. And evidently, the Cal Ripken Sr., Frank Robinson, and all the guys with the Baltimore club put so much heat on the official scorer that after reviewing the tapes again, he changed it around. But it was just a flat error.
Huh.
Took his eye off the ball. The ball hit him on the side of the glove, bounced away. The runner advanced. That's an error.
Sure.
As Espinosa steps in. So we'll see how Hibbard reacts working from the stretch. First hit of the ball game right there. And Ozzie with a stop now tries to make the play with a glove. What an excellent effort. Now there's a base hit. On a hit and run. So two infield singles by the Yankees here in the sixth inning have Hibbard in a jam.
There you see, it is hit and run. Espinosa handles the bat very well. Ozzie coming across. Just couldn't make it. He tries to flip it with his glove. That's the kind of presence on the field Ozzie has. He knows he can't get up and throw anybody. Look, he tries to flip it behind him. Can't make the play. So Roberto Kelly, very dangerous hitter. Two runners on and only one out here in the sixth inning.
Low off the plate and the count 1-0. Good fastball by Hibbard. Ball on the strike.
Let's see, Roberto Kelly with runners in scoring position hitting 259. No homers, 16 RBIs.
There's that good change. Good motion from Hibbard. And he's on top of ball and two strikes. There's that change again. Kelly trying to stay back on it. There's the on-deck hitter, second baseman Steve Sachs. Jammed him, ate him up. Infield fly rule in effect as Kittle makes the catch, and that's out number two.
Set him up for that pitch with that good changeup down and away. So there's two out. Steve Sachs, ever a dangerous out, is the hitter now. Sachse, runners in scoring position. He's hitting 255.
Well, I agree with you here in respect. Certainly, if you need a long ball, he's not the most fearsome hitter in this lineup. But in a situation such as this, indeed, he is a tough out.
Yeah.
One thing about it, if the ball's hit in the left or right, Sox have a good opportunity, if it's a line drive, to make a play on Guerin, who doesn't have a whole bunch of speed, even with a two-out situation.
Yeah, they shorten up a few steps than they would normally because of the wind factor.
Sammy, very short in right field.
And that is Sack's best stroke. Line drive to right. Seen him do that 100 times during the season. There you see that defense. They're straight away and fairly short. Pascoe playing a little deeper in the left field.
Good fastball strike, and the count evens at one. change. Excellent change. Jim Dandy.
Steve Sack's bat is not long enough, as you can see. He misses it.
Oh, high. 2-2.
July 30th on American Movie Classics.
You're Norma Desmond. Used to be in silent pictures. Used to be big.
I am big. It's the picture that got small.
The legendary Gloria Swanson gives her most memorable performance in the fascinating portrait of a dream world turned to nightmare.
All right, Mr. DeMille, I'm ready for my close-up.
William Holden co-stars in director Billy Wilder's Oscar-winning classic, Sunset Boulevard. Monday, July 30th, 8 Central on AMC.
There's something new coming to you from Budweiser. And if the label turns your head, wait till you taste it. New Bud Dry. The first beer cold-filtered for smooth draft taste. And dry brewed for no aftertaste. So if you're looking for smooth taste with no aftertaste, turn here. Try Bud Dry.
Got the summertime blues?
Toyota's got the cure for the summertime blues.
Toyota's summer sales event has the summer's biggest savings, like Toyota Corolla, with savings up to $900 or more on factory options. Then add in immediate delivery, special financing, and very special summertime factory incentives. Right now, your Toyota dealer has the cure for the summertime blues.
Toyota's got the cure for the summertime blues.
Toyota's summer sales event. Don't miss it.
No score, bottom of the sixth inning as you're looking at second baseman Steve Sachs. When he was called out by home plate umpire Dale Scott, he momentarily lost it. He was livid. Let's take a look at the fastball on a 2-2 count. He thought the pitch was outside. It was very close, and watch it. During the break there, it's amazing that he did not get run immediately.
Yeah.
So obviously there was no vulgarity involved face-to-face with Scott.
Exactly what I was going to say, yeah. That's right. Well, here we go. Hey, you know Hawkins is still working on that no-hitter.
Every time you say that, boy, you're right. Every time you say it. Here's Ozzie. Ozzie 0 for 1. No runs on two hits for the Yankees. No runs on no hits for the Sox. You know, the other night I went home, and I was watching the Valenzuela
right.
And Cincinnati game. I watched it for two innings there. I was having a sandwich. That's into left field, right at Jimmy Leyritz. One gone. So I was watching it. The score was, 3-0 at the time or something. It was like the sixth and seventh innings, or seventh and eighth. They didn't say one thing about the no-hitter.
No kidding.
I tried, you know what I did? I thought the game was over, so I switched channels to watch a movie. The next morning, I wake up, and here he pitches a no-hitter. I couldn't believe it.
Wow.
I mean, that's carrying a little too far to the viewer.
Sure.
Here's Lance. Lance has popped to second. He's bounced, popped to left, and he's bounced to second. And a reminder, the next Shy Sox Coca-Cola Luncheon will take place on Tuesday, July 24th at the Hilton Inn of Oaklawn, starting at 11:30 a.m. The luncheon will feature Jeff Torborg and Ron Kittle, and is co-sponsored by the Chicago Sun-Times. So for more information, just call the Sox at 312-924-1000.
Here comes the base hit. Lance Johnson's a high ball hitter. Andy Hawkins, a high ball pitcher. That's the equation. Here's the solution. Oh.
Sox gets a nice butterfield bounce.
All right. Robin Ventura.
I'm going to stay with Yvonne. I'm going to say Yvonne is going to break it up.
Well, let's get Robin on base, and he can maybe hit one out of here.
Yes.
Sammy Sosa came closest. Oh, he drilled that ball for the last out of last inning. Should have, could have been a three-run homer, but no. The win.
Robin line deep to right his first trip. And then he bounced hard to second, his second at bat. Two strikes. Two balls, two strikes, two out. With Calderon on deck. Just swung around to the left. One hopper right to Mattingly. He'll underhand it over to Hawkins, and that'll retire the side. Nothing across, and after six, boy, what a pitching matchup this afternoon. No score.
Hey, it's not the flying that bothers me. It's that business of getting to the planes.
You may be heading for the wrong planes.
You tell me how to get in and out of Chicago without dealing with that airport chaos, and I'll do your expense reports for the last month. Midway Airlines.
At Midway Airport. It's close to downtown, and it's a 3-minute walk from the ticket counter to the farthest gate.
I'll give Midway a try.
Well, John, you'll need these then.
Yeah.
Midway Airlines. What flying should be.
The 1980s and the Chicago White Sox. From the storybook season in 1983 to the end of the decade at historic Comiskey Park, the Chicago White Sox are a team of constant change and excitement. Take a look back at your favorite year with the White Sox by choosing one of seven videotapes or by getting the whole collection. Remember when the White Sox won the American League West by a record 20 games? Or Carlton Fisk's 2,000th hit? Or Tom Seaver's 300th career victory achieved in a Sox uniform? Don't miss this entertaining look back at the Chicago White Sox. Order your favorite year with the White Sox for only $19.95 plus $2.50 shipping and handling. Catch the memories on tape. To order, send check or money order to Sports Channel Chicago. White Sox Highlight Tape, P.O. Box 506, Oak Park, Illinois, 60303. Be sure to specify which year or years you would like to ensure quick delivery.
As you look at right-hander Andy Hawkins, we've been watching him a little bit. In between the inning here, nobody saying a word to him. And of course, usually when a pitcher has got a no-hitter going late in the ball game, like Andy does, everybody will sit in more or less the same spot on that dugout, on the bench. Nobody will talk about it. But right here, Mattingly steps in to face Greg Hibbert, who has given up but two hits. Two infield singles last inning. Strike on the outside corner, and the count evens at one. No runs, two hits, no errors for the Yankees. No runs, no hits, no errors for the Sox. Two and one the count. second baseman. Scotty Fletcher will suck it up. Say, Seaver's Dennis the Menace, isn't he?
Oh, yeah. What he does to Phil Rizzuto daily shouldn't be done.
He's
an elderly
Seaver
statesman.
Hall of Fame right-hander, now one of the Yankee broadcasters, as Bye-Bye steps in. That's cute. Yes, he did, says first baseman Mario Lou Voltaggio.
You know, you could already see the Darrell Evans influence on these hitters. Balboni used to hit with a closed stance. Now he's open right on top of the plate. That's the way Darrell Evans used to hit.
What did that thing say? If behinds were airplanes, the world would be an airport?
Yes. Behinds were could fly.
Oh,
this place would be an airport.
Here's the 0-2 pitch. Slider inside. I liked one also he said before the game, what's the difference between a terrorist and a wife? You can negotiate with a terrorist. Oh, he broke his bat, sawed him off.
Well, he did that, new lumber. Yep.
Bye-bye, I'll get a new one.
And a reminder, the Coca-Cola Shy Sox Fan Club is open to Sox fans of all ages. Members receive tickets, Comiskey Columns newsletter, and much more. Plus, the proceeds benefit the Shy Sox Research Fund and Day Hospital in the fight against terminal illness in children. For more information, call the White Sox at 312-924-1000 or stop by your neighborhood Walgreens for an application.
The ball and two strikes to Steve Balboni. Fastball off the plate. Gas him up and in. Fastball, yes. Fourth strikeout for Hibbert.
You know, Carco looks like he wants it in, and he gets it up and away, and Balboni just can't catch up with it. It is out of the strike zone. You can see by the swing right through it, so... Strikeout number four for Greg. No walks. And that's been a key for his success this year. No base on balls.
Shot, base hit. Jumped on that first ball, fastball, Barfield.
Well, that was a shot right there. He got it through that hole. Nobody could move quick enough to get in position to make that play. Wow.
I'm just glad he didn't get it up. We are just getting ready to say before the pitch, there's a first ball fastball, as I'm more afraid of a guy with sacks and having second base and two outs in this kind of a ball game. Of course, Barfield is the guy you worry about when you're looking for the long one.
Sure.
Against Hibbert.
Don't give up that single with two outs. Leyritz.
That gum right.
Get this guy and get back to work on offense.
Leyritz has bounced to short, and he's gone out to left. He made two home runs last evening. Shot over the head of Scott Fletcher. Sammy gets to it as Barfield will hold it second. Back-to-back two-out singles by Barfield and Leyritz. As you look at right-hander Barry Jones. And that'll bring up the third baseman, Mike Flowers.
Well, he got that pitch up and out over the plate, and Leyritz just hammers it. Boy, that was a good swing he put on that pitch. So, first and second, two out. Sammy Ellis out to the mound. Just a word with Greg Hibbert. Little pat on the shoulder there. Go get this guy. Big out right here for Greg. No scoring today at Comiskey Park. Both pitchers have been in a good groove. Two balls hit very hard off Greg Hibbert, though, in succession. Fortunately for the Sox, there's two outs. And the stumper looks on.
Yes, fastball right there. Bowers has bounced to Ozzie and has bounced to Robin.
Bowers looks like he's very susceptible to that inside fastball, the way he dives across.
That's off the end of the bat in the center field. Johnson broke back, now comes on and makes the catch. Nothing across, a couple of hits, no errors, two men left. They'll go to the bottom of the seventh, no score.
The summer savings advantage of value-packed Plymouth Sundance with $750 cash back, or get $1,000 back on sporty Chrysler LeBaron Coupe. Factory to dealer incentives might save you even more. Drive the Chrysler Plymouth Advantage today.
The best is what you get.
Get the best of the 90s at Schaumburg Chrysler Plymouth in Schaumburg.
Spondulix.
It's the green stuff in fruitcakes.
No, it's the study of sponges.
Spondulix, happy cabbage, legal tender. Simply put, it means money. Hence the name of the Illinois Lottery's new instant game. You could win $2 million. That's a lot of Spondulix.
Oh, great, Godfrey
Daniel. Oh, Spondulix.
Ask for it by name.
Later on.
Count to Yvonne Calderon here in the bottom of the seventh inning, no score. Right on the outside corner on a 2-0 count, boy, that's a Jim Dandy pitch right there by Andy Hawkins. 0-4-0 for the Yankees, 0-0-0 for the Sox.
I don't know. Guerin's moving around so much over there. That pitch appeared to be about 6 inches outside.
Devine in good shape right here, 3-1. See what they want to do when he's down in the.
He wants it away again. Where he's sitting.
Whoa. What a hack. Full count to Calderon. You know, he has made some outstanding locations with that fastball today. He has really spotted this fastball well.
Yeah, he's worked the hitters in and out very, very well. Get that fastball up, too, just out of the zone that the White Sox hitters like to hit at. The fastball away where he's sitting.
That's ball four, the leadoff man aboard.
Okay, Guerin looked like, to me, with those who can't see home plate, it looks like he's sitting 8 inches outside. Hits the target, and there's no way you can get that pitch. Third walk for Hawkins, and third base runner for the White Sox this afternoon. Come on, Danny.
The only other two base runners coming back in the fifth inning with two out. So, obviously, the first time the Sox have had the leadoff man aboard. Pasqua has struck out, and he's popped to left.
Ooh, he wants it away. Fastball away.
Just get it down.
Yeah. Ball right into our trap. Waiting in the bushes.
Calderon, 21 stolen bases.
You know he wants to run.
Pasqua takes a fastball over. Guerin can throw you out. He has a strong arm, for the most part, an accurate arm. And
a pretty quick release.
Yeah, he's a better thrower than Matt Noakes.
Coming with some more heat.
It's just
fastball up.
Yeah, it's just out of Danny Pasqua's zone. Danny is a much better hitter when he is taking that pitch. Because Hawkins got some pretty good velocity on it. There you see the flags. They're blowing straight in from center. What new?
Hawkins, a decent move for a right-hander. Right here, got a scratch and dig and kick and fight. Try to get one. One will be enough for Mr. Hibbert. You know what? I know how I feel about it.
I know that.
That's off the plate. I'll tell you, outside of a healthy Teddy Higuera. You're talking about a left-hander. I'd just as soon have Greg Hibbert out there as anybody in this league.
That's a pretty good compliment right there. Opponents have stolen 40 bases, 49 bases, and thrown out 40 times against the Yankee catchers this year and pitching. So they're pretty successful, the Yankees are, at throwing potential base stealers out.
They want him to go over to first base again. If you've just joined us, you have missed a Lulu. From a pitching standpoint, it has been magnificent on both sides. That's high into right center field. Now Barfield lost it, now recovers and makes a basket catch.
Oh, he snow combed that one. Oh, it's tough out there in right field. You got to battle not only the sun, but that wind bringing the ball back in. And Jesse was able to adjust and readjust there and make the play. It could have been a critical play right there. There you see it. He just finds it. But it one out now for Kitty. Well, he's making good pitches on Pasqua.
Made some pretty good pitches on most of them this afternoon. As we mentioned, his locating of the fastball has just been as nice as we have seen from anyone all year. Kitty 0 for 2. He struck out and he popped a third. I see right here, Calderon a little more intense on stealing second with one out.
Yeah, you got to think about manufacturing a run, and that would be stealing a base and then getting a base hit. Way Hawkins is dealing. Tough to get three hits in a row to score a run today.
Right there by Kitty. Trying to get it down just a shade. 4-1 to count. Trying to go over there again, I guess. No, pitch out. They're reading some mail.
No chance. Once he saw the quick release right there by Hawkins, Hawkins really sped up his delivery right there. And that's when he has got to say, retreat. And right there, that's what really threw him out. It wasn't actually the pitch out.
Boy, that, for all you young pitchers out there, is the way to do it. Is the way to do it. As far as you see, the little glide step is Kitty. Can't get it in the count 1-2 by Hawkins as far as execution. But Tom, he may have given away just a little bit, but still the point is you got to unload in a hurry to home plate, and that was textbook by Andy Hawkins.
Pull up right there. Goodbye.
On the outside corner. Nothing across. They'll go to the top of the eighth inning. A scoreless tie.
Hey, come on. Is this any way to spend the summer? No. Make it a Bud summer with Budweiser, Bud Light, and Bud Dry. Check inside 12 packs and you could win one of 100 Bud Label pools. Look for me, Jeff Altman, where you buy your favorite beer. But we're giving away pools all summer long. It's wet. It's wild. It's Bud summer. Hey, man, you need sunscreen. You're starting to peel. Whew.
The White Sox hope to keep the Brewers at the bottom of the keg throughout the weekend as they host a three-game series live from Comiskey Park. Milwaukee, led by the newest Brewmasters, Gary Sheffield and Dave Parker, has dropped two out of three games this season to the Sox. Can the Shy Sox maintain their dominance over the Brew Crew? Find out this Friday at 7 when the Sox take on the Brewers right here on Sports Channel.
Top of the eighth inning here at Comiskey Park. Scoreless tie and some replacements. Steve Lyons comes in to play first base for Ron Kittle here in the eighth inning, and the Sox are going to go with a new pitcher. Barry Jones will replace Greg Hibbard. There's the numbers on Barry, 9-1 with a 1.43 earned run average. 34th ball game this afternoon. One save for Barry. 32 hits, given up in 37 and two-thirds innings, 16 walks, 25 strikeouts. Barry Jones, the American League, hitting .235 against Barry so far this season. Greg Hibbard works seven very strong innings, gives up four hits, and that is it for Greg. He struck out four, didn't walk anybody, had another outstanding outing, but the best he can do, no decision.
It was a hearty handshake. Reminder later on tonight, right here on Sports Channel, it's Sports Nightly, your source for the up-to-minute scores, highlights, and complete coverage of the fast-paced world of sports. Catch a recap of all the day's sports, including special sports features, at Sports Nightly tonight, live at 6 and 9, exclusively on Sports Channel. Here's Bob Guerin. Slider strike. Oh, what a job by Greg Hibbert. Mercy.
He does it day in and day out.
That little bulldog is tough. Boy, once he gets his teeth into you, he ain't gonna let go.
No.
Yes, boy, that's some gas.
Whoa. Just a bit tardy.
Two. Oakland at Toronto, bottom of the eighth inning, tied at three. Garrett on the breaking ball, just got a piece of it, trying to check his swing. Cincinnati at New York in the sixth inning, a rain delay. That game tied at one. Pittsburgh leading the Giants 2-1 in the fourth, Candlestick. Phillies came back to defeat the Astros at Veterans Stadium 8-4. Montreal beat Atlanta 5-1 at Olympic Stadium, as that's out of play right side. Later on tonight, the Cardinals take on the Dodgers in Los Angeles. The Cubs at San Diego. In the bottom of the first inning, Padres lead it 1-0. That's going to be a foul ball. Harris is struggling up there against BJ.
Yeah, he's not seeing the ball real good up there. No doubt about that, especially on the breaking ball. Staying alive, though. The more pitches you see, the better chance you have of getting to the pitcher. So he's hoping that actually Barry Jones can throw one in his wheelhouse. He said so many times here in the daytime, Very tough to pick up the ball because of the background. If you got good stuff, you can win here at Comiskey. And the conditions this afternoon are absolutely perfect for the pitcher with the wind blowing in, the not so hot background behind you.
And we saw that evidenced by the towering shot off the bat of Sammy Sosa.
I'll tell you one thing, Dale Scott's not hurting these pitchers either.
Ventura guarding the line right where he should be.
Long
peg, and Lyons cannot dig it out. That'll be an error on Robin Ventura.
Well, let's take a look at it. Right down the line here, Robin is in good shape. I don't know if he really gave it that good throw right there. Certainly a very pickable ball. Going to give it... They're going to give the error to Lyons. That's a definite... That's certainly a catchable ball right
there.
Yeah,
but you can't give the error to Steve on that. He's got to be on the throw. Meanwhile, they're going to give it to Lyons.
So, Espinoza, he'll be up there to bunt. There are no doubt about it. Ninth place hitter. See how many times. He's been successful five times this season, sacrifice bunting.
If he doesn't lay down a good one, they're going to have a play on Guerin at second.
Yeah.
I'm surprised right here. The Yankees are not pinch running for him.
Yeah, that's true. Matt Noakes is the only other catcher available right now. But heck, we're in the eighth inning already. You got to go for it. That is true.
We got a situation for you up at Skydome. Oakland southpaw Rick Honeycutt has come on. And the situation is this. No runs in, bases loaded, nobody out.
Come on. I like that situation.
By Guerin. Ventura coming in. There's a bunt out in front of the mound. We'll get the job done. If Barry is coming in hard, they got a good chance of getting Guerin in a second.
Yeah, no doubt about it. Not a too particularly good of a bunt right there, but it was deadened. A little bit harder, and Jones would have had an easy play at second base. So sacrifice bunt number six for Espinoza and Scott Rudinsky heating up in the bullpen. They'll come on, I'm sure, to pitch to Mattingly if he hits in this inning. But you've got to get these two guys, Roberto Kelly and Steve Sachs. They'll have chances to drive in this all-important run.
Kelly 0 for 3. Struck out, bounced to short, and he's popped to first. Breaking ball low and away. Ball really running in on it. And the count evens at one. No runs, four hits for the Yankees. No runs, no hits for the Sox. We're in the top of the eighth inning. And you see Figge has joined Rudinsky. Deck. And Jones on top. The ball and two strikes. Got it. Big strikeout. Jones.
Oh, you got that right, Cowboy. Here's a fastball. He just buries it upstairs right there about letter high, and Kelly goes fishing. Can't catch up with it. So, Steve Stacks We'll have another RBI opportunity. It's easy for me to say. Steve Sachs, that is.
We said it earlier, this is a guy we, the right-handed hitters. Of course, that was against Hibbert. But he is a tough out. Breaking ball low and away. The catch and it'll retire the side. Nothing across. There were no hits and there a man left after 7.5. No score.
Nothing beats the USA. Nothing beats what we've got here. Nothing beats clean, crisp, cold. Nothing beats the king of beer. Yeah, nothing.
There you see it. A scoreless tie in the Sox. Well, Andy Hawkins got himself a no-hitter going. A couple of plays that could have been a little different. Robin Ventura back in the first inning hit a shot into right field at Barfield. Raced back, going away from home plate, reached up and made the catch on. And then Sammy Sosa in the fifth inning with two men on. Hawkins had walked Carcavice and Fletcher. He hammered one, a towering fly ball in the left field. As Tom mentioned last night, it was definitely upper deck. And the wind brought it back in, and Lafritz caught it right against the fence. They indeed have changed that era. It's an era on Ventura. Discard. Breaking ball outside. Hines has popped to short, and he's walked.
And Blauer's playing even with the bag at third. They know Carco's an excellent drag bunter.
Well, you want another situation up at Sky Dome?
Yes.
Sacrifice fly by Fred McGriff scored Tony Fernandez. One run in, men on first and second, one out. Blue Jays 4, Athletics 3. Ooh. Little delayed call by Dale Scott in the count 1-2.
Look where he's setting.
Pops it up right side, Sachs. Hello, Scotty, take him out of here.
Yeah. Hey, you never know.
Wrong. Scotty has flied to right and he's walked.
Somebody's going to have to do something here quick. Of course, the White Sox pitchers have been up to the task matching Hawkins almost pitch for pitch.
Yeah, in case you're looking to the Yankee ninth, Mattingly, Balboni, and Barfield scheduled hitters. And Scotty takes a strike. I can't tell. I'm looking for the bra strap. No, that's not one. What can I say? A great catch by one of our lady fans down there. No balls, two strikes.
Look at Gahe. He is in the left-handed batter's box. I can't believe where he he's setting up for some of these pitches that he wants. Whoa.
Very definitive and graphic in his moves.
Yeah. If he hits the target, you have to dive to hit the ball. He's way out there again.
Trying to snatch it. And the count, 2-2. Yankees didn't get a base hit off Greg Hibbert. He had retired the first 16 Yankees in order. Got a base hit off him. Two infield singles in the sixth inning. Check swing on the high heat. Another nice catch as you look at the on-deck hitter, Sammy Sosa. Him up right side. Sachs once again fighting that side. So with two outs here in the eighth, is up to Sammy. Fly to right, and we mentioned he just missed one back in the fifth inning. And this by far, the last five or six ball games, is by far the most dangerous Sammy has been at the plate. Georgia, yes.
Uh-huh.
Now feels straight away, spread out, breaking ball strike.
Expando plate. Pitch down and away. That's tough to reach that one. Again.
Wrong day, old man. Wrong.
Jeez. I'll tell you. Now, right there, those last two pitches are impossible to hit. They're not.
Come on.
No one can hit those pitches. If you had to make a career hitting those, you'd hit zero. There he is farther out.
One and two the count.
I'll tell you, next time, Guerin's going to set up in the on-deck circle. He's going to hit his target.
It's a breaking ball again.
It is.
Flowers drops it, now picks it up. Long throw, not in time.
With the call, the Yankees are, that is. Sammy Sosa credited with a base hit.
Oh, they give him a hit on that?
Yeah. Breaking up the no-hitter. It's a breaking ball hanging inside. You can see Blowers not really guarding the line right there.
He can't get him a hit on that.
Yeah. And he just let the ball eat him up right there. Really not as difficult a play as I thought, but watch this gun that Blowers has. My goodness, he got it there in a hurry. Just barely missing. They change it.
I want Sammy to get the hit, but that's there's Bob. He's changed it now. It's an arrow. That's the correct call, Bob. Much as I want to see Sammy get that hit, you can't give him a hit on that. That's a flat boot.
Yeah, you let that ball play him a bit. There's no question about that. He had a tremendous topspin on that ball. So, runner on. Let's see what Sammy's got in store for us. I got to think, with Lance the hitter with two outs, he's got to try and steal this base. Oh, no, Ozzy. I'm sorry. Ozzy's the hitter. Lance Johnson on deck. If he gets thrown out, so what? We still have Ozzy and Lance to lead things off next inning. Go for it. Guerin has shown us an outstanding throwing arm today. 13 for 23. Ozzie, very unlikely today to be able to drive in that runner from first base right now with two out. They'll go for it.
Well, they pitched down on Calderon. They're reading his anticipation. Fastball up high in the count 1-0.
Well, they're definitely in this situation. Guerin is looking for the fastball away with Guillen. Number one, they're pitching it, playing him away, so you might as well pitch him that way, too, with the fastball. And, of course, when you throw the fastball away, it really helps the catcher's chances of throwing out a fast base stealer, Sammy Sosa. There it is again.
It does, but he has been staying. He has... That has been his pitch today, the number one. He has spotted that pitch extremely well. In fact, he reminds me a little bit the way he's pitching this afternoon, the way Richard Dotson did back in 1983 for the Sox, spotting his fastball.
Yeah. Not the same velocity. Dot threw the ball harder, but with more velocity.
Yeah.
You're right.
There goes Sammy.
He had a chance there.
Play. Yeah, that would have been, I think Sammy would have made it.
Yeah. Up and in fastball, too. Tough pitch to throw on for Guerin. And probably in and out of the strike zone, too. Ozzie having a little bit of difficulty right now getting the head of the bat out like he was early on.
Has bounced to short, fly to left, 0 for 2, 0 for 9 in this series. And a count of ball and two strikes.
Oh, I'd like to see a gapper right now.
I was
right
looking at it. Reading my mail there, kid. I was just looking right out there trying to bisect Barfield and Kelly.
Oh, man. Room abundance. Man. Let Sammy get on his horse and run forever.
Top of the ninth inning, Skydome. Honecker must have done a good job.
You're not
kidding.
Out of
that thing with one run.
That's a great job. Give him a chance. That's all they wanted. Come on, Henke.
Come on, Splitter.
Big horse, you.
Earn your money. There goes Sammy. Guerin, no! Stolen base, number 14 for Sosa.
Now Hawkins gave him a chance right here, but it's that tough inside fastball to throw on. Guerin not quite as quick on that pitch as he was last time. Delivers the throw just a tad up, and Sammy's in there. Though.
It was, but as you mentioned earlier, that high inside fastball, a little tougher on Guerin, too.
Come on, 3-2. Got great speed at second.
Score, bottom of the eighth inning.
I love Sam. Sammy Sosa is so much fun out there. He's cheerleading for Ozzy at second base, clapping his hands, wanting to get things going. He's checking those outfielders. Like he was described as a panther, just stalking back and forth. Issued by Hawkins.
And here comes Lance. Lance has popped to left. He's bounced to second in the fourth inning. He's bounced to second in the sixth inning. And Wimpy, I think you're right. You called it. You knew it all the time.
Well, all Lance has to do is get that big hit. They're playing him basically the same way they did Ozzy out in the outfield. Big gap between Barfield and Kelly. Now Kelly moves a little bit over towards straightaway center field. The Lancer Root.
That's off the plate and count 1-0. Good speed aboard, and Sosa and Guillen. It's 2-0. I can get it down. There's Robin on deck. See what he's going to do right here, if he's just going to stay out there until he can give home plate umpire Dale Scott a piece of his mind, or they're just going to talk the situation over with Mandy. He's got a no-hitter going here in the bottom of the eighth inning. Stump might be just trying to wait. No, he's not either. Thought he was going to wait and come out there and give a little chit-chat to Scott.
Yeah, I was thinking the same thing. But no.
That's the wrong time to start getting on an umpire's case.
Yeah,
bases
that's right.
Loaded in a scoreless tie.
Woo. Well, Robin Ventura. Robin's had a couple decent at-bats.
And a couple of good at-bats.
Yep.
Sammy at third, Ozzy at second, Lance at first. Field bunch swung around to the left. That's hitting the left field playable. Leyritz fighting the wind. Dumps the ball! Dumps the ball! Everybody's going to score, and the Sox lead it 3-0. Yes!
played third base the first two games of this series. And I'll tell you what, that ball carried very, very well right there. The ball had been coming in all afternoon in defense of Leyritz. Now watch this. It doesn't appear to be going very well. Didn't hit it very well. Now he is just, that ball is bouncing around on him right there. You can see him getting his angle turned around. He had no chance. He was bouncing. His head was bouncing the whole time. He was on his heels. And that's what happens to you. He really got spun himself around a couple times. Great break for the White Sox. Oh, my.
Calderon takes it off the plate. Sox with three runs on no hits.
Wow.
Woo, boy, there's something. See, right here, possibly something you don't see a whole bunch of. A no-hitter thrown and you win the game.
Yeah. Oh, my. Well, the five walks didn't help Hawkins today. Well, I'll tell you, Leyritz, he just did not get the proper jump. The wind is really playing tricks out there. All right. How about this?
Yes. Sox can move back into first place. To the score just posted on the board. Blue Jays over the A's 4-3. This all started with two out on a great at bat by Sammy Sosa, getting down in the count quickly. No, 0-2. That's lifted in the right field. Jesse is there fighting that wind. Anderson, now he drops it. Robin scores and the Sox lead it 4-0.
Whoa. Well, the baseball gods are literally shining on the White Sox this afternoon. Mercy. That's what Andy Hawkins needs right now is a little mercy. He delivers the fastball up and away. Calderon hits what appears to be a routine fly to right. Here's Jesse Barfield battling the wind and the sun, loses it. Bingo. E9s. White Sox lead it 4-0. And Pasqua.
Takes the strike.
Hey, Hawk, do you remember when this inning started so harmlessly? The first two guys made routine outs. E5 set this whole thing up. A couple of walks and two more errors. Bingo.
0-2 count to Sammy right off the bat before he battled into the 2-2 count and then reached base on the error.
Yep.
Three errors this inning for the Yankees to go along with two walks. And the Sox lead it 4-0. No runs, four hits, three errors for the Yankees. Four runs, no hits, one error for the Sox. Outside, Wimpy in defense of Leyritz and Barfield. Well, you've been out there and I have been out there in this field on days like this when you just pray they didn't hit it to you.
Yeah. That's right. Yeah, you're right.
Just sit out there and pray they didn't hit it to you.
Sun and wind. Sun and wind.
That's off the plate on the count. 2-1.
Jesse had a good beat on that ball. He was right there and all of a sudden went right into that big ball of fire out there in the sky. No clouds to help you out today. And Leyritz, that ball just carried a little bit farther than it had been because everything had been coming back into the infield early in the ball game. That ball shot out there to left field pretty good, almost to the warning track.
2-2. Seems like the fans now are pulling for Hawkins to get the no-hitter because the Sox have the 4-0 lead.
That's exactly right.
How about this for a little bit of irony? How about the 80th birthday of Comiskey Park, the last time the New York Yankees will ever play a game here, seeing a no-hitter thrown in that game, and the Yankees lose it?
Game's full of irony, isn't it?
That's why it's just the greatest game.
And the Vulture has a chance.
Vulture, is he around again? Can you believe Barry Jones is around again, 10-1?
He's
here.
Thinking,
hold on.
Swooping down. He's going to swoop down, hopefully. Oh, mercy.
Jammed him, popped him up. That'll be caught by Espinoza. Makes the catch, and the side is retired, but not before the Sox come up with four runs, all of them unearned. Oh, no hits, three errors, a man left. They'll go to the ninth inning, leading it, 4-0 with no hits.
For the news in this town, you gotta have fast feet and a big heart because this is a gutsy town and nobody.
Stock prices soared Monday to their highest level since last autumn, while analysts predicted the market may find little.
As a sports writer, you can't just watch the game. You gotta completely absorb it. Every play, every pitch, every strike.
What you'll find on a stage in this town. Chicago's brand of theater is like the city itself. Bold, physical, nervous.
Get it straight from the heart of the city, the Chicago Sun-Times. Chicago's number one selling newspaper.
And in case you just tuned in, as we look at some defensive changes, Gallagher moves into left field in place of Pasqua. And a new pitcher, Scott Rudinsky, coming in to face Mattingly. Here's the story in case you just joined us. The Sox coming up with four runs on no hits in the eighth inning to break the scoreless tie. Three errors committed by the Yankees. So the totals on the board for the Yankees, no runs on four hits, three errors. For the Sox, four runs on no hits and one error. Fastball strike. I was talking with Stump Merrill and Mark Connors and Mark Hill after the game last evening. The one guy they were just absolutely raving about on this ball club was that 22-year-old left-hander out there. I guess they tried everything they could to talk the Yankees into trying to get him and give the Sox anything they wanted to get rid of.
No kidding.
Yeah. That's hit hard in the center field. Lance is there. Mattingly now 0 for 4.
Can't believe it.
There's a man who has just pitched himself a no-hitter, and he's down 4-0. Well, you don't think he's in the slump?
Now, he gets credit for a no-hitter for this, right? Eight innings?
You got that right.
Sure, okay. So make sure. I'm sure there's some.
Here's Balboni. Let me see. I know that Ken Johnson pitched a no-hitter for Houston and was beaten 1-0.
Right.
And it's happened several times in baseball's history. There's Balboni, count 1-1. The count 1-2. Garfield having a problem on deck. Now it's all taken care of. Watch out. Off the facing. Count remains 1-2.
Well, it goes to show you, when you get good pitching on your side and you make the plays defensively, anything can happen. Good grief, I still can't get over this.
Sheesh.
Jammed him, ate him up. Ventura bobbles it and cannot make the play. Well, the second arrow. Robin just flat let that ball play him right there.
Yeah. It looked like he thought that ball was hit harder than it actually was. So Balboni gets first base. There's one out. Barfield will be the hitter. Let's look at the replay. He gets jammed with the fastball. Look at her. Instead of coming forward to meet it on the short hop, Robin waited back, something he hasn't done all year. Waited back, let the ball play him, and so he has his second error on the afternoon. So Wayne Tolleson comes in to run for Balboni. Barfield the hitter. He has one hit this afternoon, one for three, a solid single in the seventh inning. So one out, runner on.
Jesse's bounced to short, struck out, and singles sharply to the left. Takes it low off the plate. To Jesse Barfield. Andy Hawkins gave up four unearned runs on no hits in eight innings. Just inside the count, 2-2.
There's a bullet right in on the hands of Jesse.
This could be it. Awesome. Fletcher, rack him up. And the ball game is over as the Sox get no hit by Andy Hawkins, and they win it 4-0. Yes!
I've always loved watching baseball. Nothing beats an ice-cold Coke at Comiskey Park. But being from a family of centers, I was never too good at playing baseball.
You could get hurt trying to catch a curve this way.
Kids, get White Sox baseball cards at the July 29th Sox Brewers game. And hear the Sox on All News 67.
The last season in historic Comiskey Park. Years from now, you'll say you were there.
From the standpoint of how well you pitch a no-hitter and you lose it 4-0, your feelings as you went into that eighth inning?
Well, it was just a nothing-nothing ball game. I don't know how long we'd be out there, and I just wanted to hold them, give us a chance to win, you know, to win. And it's kind of ironic the way it turned out. It's a tough outfield out there right now. The wind's blowing in hard, and it's playing all kinds of tricks with the ball. And it's a tough play, couple of plays out there, and it just didn't go our way, but the guys are giving their best, and we're all giving our best. Just didn't work out.
I could read the frustration in your body when you walked off the field. I know it's very tough not giving up a hit and walk off and know you're down 4-0.
I tell you what, it's really tough to throw a no-hitter and get beat. I don't know of too many instances where I've seen that happen, but I threw well, and I feel good about my own performance today. We're doing okay. I think we're going to be all right. We just need to just keep our heads up and stay with it.
The one ball that was hit hard, it looked like it was going to be a base hit, was the ball hit by Sammy Sosa in the fifth inning, and the wind kept that ball in the ballpark. And that was really the closest thing to a base hit.
Without a doubt, he got all that ball. Any other night, and any other night that we played here, and that ball's in the upper deck easy. So the wind helped me out there, and it saved me three runs and a hit right away.
You know, ironically, 80 years ago, this ballpark was opened, and there was a no-hitter pitched in this ballpark, and the pitcher lost it.
Is that right? Very ironic.
It's a little history coming back to haunt you, isn't it?
Yeah, I tell you, that's the way the year's going right now, and that's kind of par for the course, but we're going to grind it out. We've got a long ways to go. We can still make a success out of it.
The way you've struggled the first part of the season, but the last four or five times out of the mound, you have pitched spectacular baseball. Even though the loss and no-hitter, et cetera, you've got to be very happy the way you've been pitching.
Well, thank you, Tom. I appreciate it. It was kind of a struggle early, but I could have won my last four starts, I think. And I feel very confident about the way I'm throwing the ball right now. And the biggest thing is just to carry it over 5 days from now and keep it going.
I think you'd probably give up one base hit and take a win, wouldn't you?
Without a doubt.
Go good. Good luck. Keep pitching the same way. Andy Hawkins, a no-hitter today, 4-0, a loss. A very tough loss for him. A very tough loss for the Yankees, and a piece of history made here at Comiskey Park. All right, let's go back upstairs.